to have all of you here. My name is Helen Andrews. I'm the editor-in-chief of the Pepperdine Law Review. We'd like to thank our distinguished guests, our students, and our speakers for being with us today, as well as our live stream, which is, I believe, just starting. Today, we're going to have an amazing and very timely symposium. Thank you to the Senate for making this probably the most timely law review symposium that's occurred here. In addition, we have a few changes to the schedule, so I'm going to highlight those briefly. We have our first panel is going to take place in Classroom B, and that is on the Supreme Court politicization historical development. Then we have Panel 2, which is taking place in Classroom A, on is the court unduly political, followed by our panels on Supreme Court reform. Panels 3 and 4 are now at 3 p.m., so don't be late, and those are taking place in Classroom F. And finally, our fifth panel on restructuring the court and appointment process, which is in the appellate courtroom, which is this room. Those are our five afternoon panels. Please silence your cell phones now. We'd greatly appreciate that. And lastly, I have the distinguished honor to introduce someone who needs no introduction, our distinguished Dean, Donnell Taha, who is leaving us this May, to everyone's dismay, but we are so appreciative of the time she has spent here. As you know, she was a former 10th Circuit Chief Justice, and then more importantly, was our dean for the last 6 years. So if you could please welcome Dean Taha.
Oh, thank you, Helen, and thank you to all of you for being with us today. Helen, of course, as always, kind of stole my line, but how did we get so lucky to have probably the most timely topic on the day after Justice Gorsuch was confirmed? We were having a little sidebar this morning. We kind of suspect he might have already been sworn in, but if he hasn't been, it'll be within probably a few hours or at least a few days. It's truly my privilege to welcome all of you. But before I recognize so many just very distinguished constitutional law scholars, I want to say a word of thanks to our law review. Helen, Alice Anderson, and all of you who have worked on this. This was no small undertaking. As you can see, it's a lineup that will be the envy of many people. And it was largely due to the inspiration of our law review staff, and they have worked just amazingly hard on this. So would you give them a big hand for doing it? They were led so ably by Professor Barry McDonald, and I don't know how well you know Barry, But he does not let something go when he starts with it. So when you're the dean and he's trying to get speakers, your email pings about 3 or 4 times a day and your phone rings about 3 or 4 times a day. Who do you think would be good? Who do you think? And then, oh, by the way, would you call them? And then, so Barry, thank you for your leadership and your insight and vision for this. I really appreciate that. Give Barry a hand. Today's lineup of speakers, as I said, will be the envy of the country because we have gathered together on this topic people who have thought about it, written about it, taught about it, and spoken to the nation and the world about it for a very long time, and done so with great insight. In these days of what I would call cacophony of rhetoric, the opportunity to sit down in a thoughtful way and address one of the most important issues of our time, in my judgment, is a very, very important point in time. And that's what I see today as. I see today as a chance for serious consideration, not just of the rhetoric, indeed not of the rhetoric at all, but rather of all the philosophical, economic, political, ideological, I could go through social, cultural issues that underlie the question of the role of the Supreme Court, what it is and may have become, and where we go from here. And I'm so happy that this afternoon we will be looking at sort of what are the next steps? Because it's one thing to dissect a problem, it's entirely a different thing to sort of consider what are the constructive ways to address it. So I want to take one point of personal privilege and say that it is truly an honor to be with my former colleague, Judge Michael McConnell. Judge McConnell said last night and has said many times, we disagreed, and we did. When we did so very publicly, but we didn't do so very often. And it was really a privilege to serve with him. We both were proud members of the Tenth Circuit Court of Appeals, and he now, of course, is up at Stanford doing a marvelous job up there and doing some great litigation in this area. So enough for me. Barry, would you like to take over? Thank you, and welcome to Pepperdine.
Well, thank you, Danelle, and I apologize if I harassed you during all of this, but I'll make it up to you somehow. Welcome, everyone. I want to say particular thanks to Alice Anderson and Suzanne Inman for helping me put this together, but a lot more thanks to follow after this event closes. Okay, well, we've experienced some interesting events concerning the Supreme Court over the past 14 months since Justice Scalia passed away. Some might say even historically singular events, but I'll leave that to our legal historians today to debate that. But one thing is certain, however, the ideological composition of the court has become a veritable political battleground. And the so-called nuclear option, adopted the other day by the Senate, only threatens to intensify the political rancor. But why, one may ask, has it come to this? If to paraphrase from the great Chief Justice John Marshall, if the Supreme Court is fairly accorded the high appellation of being an institution of laws and not of particular women and men, if it was truly an institution of laws, then why would it matter what the political ideology of a particular nominee was? Is it because, as some hold, that constitutional interpretation is inevitably part politics, given the broad and open provisions of that charter? Did the great Marshall fail to see that the Constitution we are expounding, as he famously declared, is incompatible with the court being exclusively committed to the rule of law? Or is the court faithfully abiding by that rule? And perhaps the partisan rancor is emerging from factors external to that body's performance. And finally, if the court is not doing all it can to keep politics out of its decision making, how can we realistically achieve changes to that institution to address this? Or are we as American citizens destined, like Sisyphus repeatedly laboring up his hill, to be resigned to this, some might call, anti-democratic fate, particularly given the entrenched provisions of the Constitution? Well, I don't nearly have the answers to these difficult questions, but I'm hoping that the great minds that we've brought together today will help us illuminate these problems. Excuse me. And we start this morning with one of the best minds in this field, Professor Michael McConnell. And Professor McConnell is the Richard and Francis Mallory Professor and director at the Constitutional Law Center at Stanford Law School. Professor McConnell is so distinguished that he need not have any further introduction, and we need to get to his remarks, but refer to the biography in the brochure if you want more details of his illustrious career so far. Please welcome Michael McConnell.
Thanks very much. Nothing better than a brief introduction. I assume that in part I was asked to kick off this very interesting conference because I've been through it and come out the other side. That, you know, I was nominated, I was declared by the majority leader of the Senate to be one of the four most controversial nominees of George W. Bush. I had four New York Times reporters assigned over a period of 2 weeks to do nothing but try to investigate my record, including interviewing students about how I taught various controversial questions. It was really kind of scary. And then I made it through, and in the end, by voice vote, by the way, unanimously approved. I'm very proud of that. The next morning in class, I told my students I was unanimously confirmed. How many votes would you guess it takes to be unanimously confirmed? And they said, well, 100. You know, there are 100 members of the Senate. I got one vote because there was only one person on the floor. The majority leader, and he moved unanimous consent. So, but what was so interesting about this process, which was really quite brutal, literally the day before I was confirmed, it was nip and tuck. And then, as soon as confirmation is over, I enter a court where politics is never discussed, where the law is everything, where Democratic judges and Republican judges sit together, not just civilly and cordially, but constructively. Of course I knew who the Democrats and the Republicans were. It's not as if politics doesn't exist, but it is an entirely different world on the other side of the curtain. It's like whiplash, right? You go from one of the most intensely political environments into one of the most constructively non-political environments in our system. So I assume that experience is a lot of why I was invited to speak today. I am going to talk about the process, the confirmation process, a little bit toward the end. But what really interests me more is the question of the judiciary's own politics. Many people say, well, you know, law, and especially constitutional law, is nothing but politics by a different name. You know, other people, you know, very frequently those who are up for confirmation say, oh, it's all law. We don't do anything but just follow the law here, Senator. I do believe, I mean, I really seriously disbelieve the view that law is just politics. That is not my experience at all. The vast number of cases in the federal courts today are decided dispassionately, objectively, frequently unanimously. When not unanimously, there isn't necessarily a partisan breakdown because you know, a lot of the cases are hard and people will decide them differently. But the vast majority of cases are not politicized in the way the press and politicians make them out to be. Some are, especially those that touch most closely on hot-button, culturally controversial questions. Sometimes the courts seem to lose their bearings as a court of law in those cases. There's much more law than politics going on in the courts. But let's talk about the politics, because it would be naive and indeed just completely inaccurate to say that there's no politics at all. So with the caveat that I do not mean for what I'm now to be talking about to describe the entire universe of the judicial process, I'd like to talk about the politics of the judiciary and ask the question, what politics does the judiciary actually have? And I'm going to propose five different kinds of politics that characterize the judiciary. The first, and I think perhaps the most obvious, is that the federal judiciary represents the educated elite of the United States. Of course it does. Whether they're Democratic appointments or Republican appointments, every one of them is someone who had a very good educational background. They all went to law school. That alone separates them from the vast number of our fellow citizens. They all did well. They were all successful. They are all from the educated elite. When you look at the United States Supreme Court, I am sorry to say, this grieves me terribly, but every one of them went to either Harvard or Yale Law School. That is really, and I was kind of hoping, I mean, I'm extremely delighted with Neil Gorsuch as the new justice, but one thing I'm not delighted about is he did too, right? I think we could use some people from Stanford or Pepperdine. at least he's not didn't grow up on one of the coasts. I mean, he has a little bit of diversity, but the educated elite, and this matters because the educated elite of America have a different set of opinions and values than the rest of America. I don't mean always, but as a rule, this is actually, you know, it's a bigger divide, I think, than men and women, or probably even than race or religion. The educated elite have very strong views that very frequently differ from most people. The school prayer decisions are a great example of this. I haven't seen any recent data on this. Maybe the Gallup organization has stopped polling the school prayer cases now. But for many years, the Gallup poll would indicate opposition to the school prayer decisions running in the 70s, 80s, sometimes even low 90s%, depending how the question is put. The American people didn't like that. But this is an issue on which judges, Republican and Democrat, are completely as at one. This is a completely firmly held view. This is just one of those divides between the highly educated elite and the rest. Capital punishment is like this. Abortion like this. I don't need to go on. Essentially, what we have done by giving the judiciary the kind of authority it has to invalidate legislation passed by state legislatures, Congress, and actions by executive branches, essentially what we have done is we have given the educated elite a veto over the actions that have been approved politically by that great mass of the American citizenry. Now, I'm not sure that's a bad thing. I mean, I'm pretty educated myself. I guess I'm part of the elite. And I also know that our framers considered very seriously the virtues of having a branch of government that was going to represent the educated elite, the natural aristocracy. Not a hereditary aristocracy, but a natural aristocracy. They spoke in terms of mixed regime theory, which they took from Aristotle and Polybius, but more recently in their reading from Blackstone and Montesquieu. The idea and the idealistic vision of the British system, in which you had a king, the one, and then you had the House of Lords, and you had the House of Commons. The House of Commons would bring about an insistence upon the common good, but the House of Lords would have a kind of detached, longer view. I mean, the fact that they were landed wealthy and their sons were going to inherit and their grandsons meant that they had a self-interest in the long-term welfare of the country, and they had the leisure and education to be able to evaluate what was going on and thus provide a counter to the House of Commons. Well, we couldn't do that because we didn't have an aristocracy. And if you read the records from the Federal Convention, you'll see, though, that many of the founders struggled with trying to figure out a way to have a mixed constitution even in American society where we lacked a hereditary monarchy or a hereditary aristocracy. Their answer was the United States Senate. They thought that the Senate would serve as a kind of aristocratic second body because the senators would be chosen by the state legislatures, and this would give a kind of the people will vote their state legislatures. That's a little bit popular, but then the state legislatures will select the best people. Of course, you want to send the best people to represent your state, and this would, and the senators would serve for the unfathomably long period of time, from their point of view, 6 years, and thus take a long view. Well, things have not quite worked out that way, and we eliminated this mode of choosing the Senate over 100 years ago. That's not what it's, but maybe the courts have accidentally taken the place in our system of being the aristocratic form of government. Let's think about them as a House of Lords, right? That the Supreme Court and the lower federal judiciary are in a sense a House of Lords that have a veto over the rambunctious activities of the more popular branches. Now, I'm not going to argue whether that's a good thing or a bad thing. Again, I have to admit that I retain enough of my middle class, flyover, church-going, public school, Big Ten university roots to be entirely pleased with this. I guess I'm more in the skeptic camp, but I can certainly see the logic of a system in which the educated elite have a strong thumb on the scale as part of a balance of politics. And I certainly suspect that that most people like yourselves who are in that educated elite will also see the virtues of having such a system. So that's the first kind of politics the judiciary represents, is an elite educated politics. The second thing is that the judiciary represents the past, and specifically they represent past political majorities. This is a feature of the fact that judges are named when they are usually in their 40s or 50s, sometimes a little older, very, very occasionally a little bit younger. But basically, and then they live, they have life tenure, so that typically a judge will serve for, you know, 25, 30 years, something like that. And it creates a federal judiciary that's sort of a layer cake, where you have remnants of past political majorities still sitting. Look at the United States Supreme Court. Our current court, at least as of when Neil Gorsuch takes his oath of office, is a court in which will have one justice who was named by Ronald Reagan, one justice who was named by the first President Bush, two justices who were named by President Clinton, two justices who were named by the second President Bush, two justices who were named by President Obama, one justice named by President Trump, which is to say it's a layer cake. It represents not just current political majorities, but the majorities in the past represented by the presidents and the who nominated them in the Senates, who confirmed them. This is, I think, a very interesting thing from a political science point of view, right? What does it do? It gives a kind of stability to the system. It works against presidents who are going to lurch in a very different direction. President Reagan was a transformative president. He got hugely restrained by the federal judiciary. President Obama was the next truly transformative president, and he was seriously restrained by the federal courts. I think now of such issues as, you know, net neutrality, struck down several times before they finally get it through. A lot of the Clean Air Act, global warming stuff, struck down, his attempt to make recess appointments in the face of Senate opposition struck down. Perhaps most conspicuously, his immigration order having to do with the undocumented workers who had been here for a while and had children in the United States, struck down. The past has its claim on us, and this system works for stability. It works against radical change, and it's deeply conservative. But I want to stress that that is small c conservative. It is not right wing. Many times the past was more left wing than the present, and then to be conservative is to have a left, is to preserve a vote for the left-wing majorities of the past. And so this is interesting. I'm not going to say it's good or bad. Actually, my view is that this is probably good. This is probably a good thing that if we're going to have a politics of the judiciary. Now, a third thing that's characteristic of the politics of the judiciary is partisan balance. That during an 8-year presidential term, and this goes back now several different, for quite some time, my entire lifetime, a president within an 8-year term of office names roughly 40% of the lower federal judiciary and 2 members of the Supreme Court. And this means that at the beginning of a term, the judiciary tends to be predominantly of the other party. By the end of the term, the majority shifts, but it never shifts overwhelmingly one way or the other. The Supreme Court and the lower federal courts are, I believe, the most partisanly balanced institutions in American political life. Now, this is the product of what might be political happenstance. This is not baked into the system the way the first two characteristics are. This is a product of the fact that the American people tend to shift the presidency back and forth between the two parties on an 8-year basis. In my lifetime, and indeed, I guess, since World War II, this has always happened. 8-year Republican presidencies are succeeded by 8-year Democratic presidencies. The only exception to this was when Jimmy Carter failed of getting reelected. So the Republicans got 12 years instead of their usual 8. And as long as this continues, and I think there, I don't know, I'm not a political scientist, there may be deep-seated reasons why this tends to happen. Presidencies run out of steam by the end. They seem to have, they don't have any interesting ideas anymore. They nominate people like Hillary Clinton for president at the end of 8 years, or the Republicans barely had anybody at all to nominate 8 years before that, and nominated John McCain. You know, the parties run out of steam at the end of 8 years, and something new is going to appeal. And so I think it may be a deep-seated aspect of American politics. I kind of hope so, because at least for its effects on the judiciary, you could hardly have come up with a better system for creating a judiciary with ideological balance. Fourth point is maybe a footnote to that, but within this overall ideological balance, we have regional diversity. And the reason for this is that different parts of the country are overwhelmingly one party or the other. So you have a very large state, California, here we are, it's a one-party state. And that's why the Ninth Circuit is the way it is. I won't describe them. Because I have friends on the Ninth Circuit, and they wouldn't like an objective description to be made in public. And then you have states like Texas, which accounts for why the Fifth Circuit is the way it is. You have other parts of the country, like the Fourth Circuit, in which the dominant states, Virginia and North Carolina, are purple states. They go either way. And so the Fourth Circuit lurched from being the most conservative circuit in the country to being one of the most liberal circuits in the country. It is not reliably one thing or the other. The Third Circuit has a little bit of each, and so it's a little bit mixed. And so we have regional courts of appeals, and they have different political or partisan character. I say that is an unequivocally a good thing, because it means that as national issues come up and percolate around the country, we get different points of view. Now, if most or all of the courts of appeals agree, given that kind of diversity, it's probably a pretty good indication that they're doing the right thing, and the Supreme Court isn't going to grant cert, and all is well. So we solve a lot of problems just by having a diverse set of courts of appeals, and then and then not disturbing what they do. When they decide cases differently, that's probably an indication that it's a hard question, and it is going to go up to the United States Supreme Court, and then we get their answer. But the court's answer is going to be enriched by having had lower court opinions, which are written from different points of view, that are going to illuminate the problem and lead, one hopes, to a more reflective answer than if all we were getting were one thing. A final point is that to the extent that the judiciary leans one way or the other, it leans toward the opposition party to the party that holds the presidency. And the reason for this is basically that when a president like President Trump or earlier President Obama comes into power, he comes in after there's been 8 years of appointments from the other party. And so it takes time. By the end of their terms, an eight-year president will by and large have his friends in power, but it takes time before that is going to happen. And so for a large part of a presidency, the president is going to get a skeptical reaction from the courts. Now, I hope that skeptical doesn't mean, you know, sort of partisan opposition. I do fear, looking at a couple of recent opinions, that maybe the judiciary is responding to the view that maybe, you know, there's something not legitimate about President Trump, and maybe it's okay to indulge presumptions against good faith decision making when those decisions are coming from President Trump. I hope that that isn't happening, but it may be. But if so, it's only a more intense version of something every president faces, because the courts were largely named by his predecessors. Here I'm referring more to the lower courts than to the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court changes more slowly than the lower courts, but the lower courts are where a great deal of the action is on review of executive action. And so I think the courts have emerged as a result of this as possibly the most important check and balance in our system. It wasn't intended that way, I don't think. I do believe that the framers had a much more law-like, legalistic, non-political view of what the courts were going to be doing. But today, Congress doesn't serve very well as a check against the president. A variety of changes in the way Congress works, including the filibuster, have made it very difficult for Congress to respond effectively to presidential actions of which they disapprove. It's very hard to get anything done in Congress. The checks and balances within Congress are so powerful, very difficult to get anything done. And if Congress can't get anything done, then the president can get away with a lot more, because the only way Congress is going to be able to check the president is if Congress is able to move. I also think the increasing partisanship within Congress has had a huge effect upon this. There was a time, I always worry about this, especially as I get older, you know, the sort of view that in my youth things were much better. But I do actually believe that there was a time, and I think I remember that time, when there were leading members of Congress who cared about the institutional power of Congress vis-a-vis the executive and would stand up to the president, even of their own party, when they believed that the president was overstepping his institutional authority. In my constitutional law course, I teach probably more congressional materials than most people do. I don't stick just to Supreme Court opinions. One of the things that I teach has to do with the president's authority to disregard acts of Congress that the president believes to be unconstitutional but have not been struck down by the courts. And one of the things that the students read is a 1986 House of Representatives report on an action by President Reagan, in which Reagan instructed his subordinate officials not to comply with an act of Congress that he believed to be unconstitutional, which footnote, 2 years later, the Supreme Court sided with President Reagan on this. But in the meantime, the House of Representatives believed, the Judiciary Committee believed it was an utter outrage that a president would not carry out an act of Congress, and issued a scathing, scalding denunciation of President Reagan's action. It was passed unanimously. Even the Republicans on the House Judiciary Committee joined in that opinion. This was another age. It was an age in which institutional arrangements mattered to members of Congress more than partisan loyalties. That age, I think, is over, although I do expect that given the rather peculiar relationship that the longtime Democrat Donald Trump has with his own party, we might see a certain revival of that. But we haven't seen it yet. But well, maybe we have. It could be that this that the investigations of the supposed ties with Russia are an indication that Congress is going to take seriously its responsibility of investigating and curtailing the actions of an executive. But certainly it wasn't done during the last administration, and very little, maybe only toward the end when the Democrats took over, was it done under President George W. Bush. But if Congress is not going to provide much of a check and balance against the president, who will? Well, the courts are much better situated institutionally to do that, because they do have life tenure, and because for most of a president's term, the courts are going to have been predominantly named by the other political parties. So that to the extent courts have a politics, so what have I said here? If to the most of what they do, I think, is law. I don't want to be confused with saying that the courts are just political bodies, but to the extent that they have a politics, it's a politics of the educated elite. It's a politics that gives some weight to the opinions of the past, and thus a kind of conservative, small c, conservative stability sort of bias. Much more bipartisan, much more balanced in a partisan way than any other institution of government, with regional diversity that works out, I think, in a constructive way, and that tilts a little bit against the party of that occupies the presidency at any moment, and thus serves, I think, as probably the most important check and balance in the system. If I have described this correctly, I hope everyone has this reaction of, well, there's some good and some bad in that. But at least as I hear myself talk, it's not a bad system overall. Maybe the politics of the judiciary is not something that we should be bewailing as much as it is just appreciating. Now, it does take, it requires that we take a step back from any of our particular partisan attachments, right? Because it's so easy when we see the courts doing something that doesn't really seem that right under the law, but and which favors the ideology of the other side. It's so easy to rail against a politicized judiciary. I've done it myself. I'll probably do it again. But when you take a step back and think of the overall politics of the judiciary, I think it's not entirely a bad thing. So how does this relate to the issue of the process, the confirmation process in particular? If I'm right about the overall politics of the judiciary, I believe it follows from this that we should not favor increasing the authority of the Senate in the process. And in particular, I think that it's probably a bad idea to empower Senate minorities to be able to have an effective blocking mechanism for presidential appointments, that by and large this is more likely to do more harm than good. And here the late and, for me, unlamented filibuster is a very good example. Now, what's the argument for the other side? What's the argument for empowering the minority in particular through a mechanism like the filibuster? The argument, I think, is quite straightforward, and it is that it will make it more difficult for the president to name extreme and unfit characters. And unfit was Alexander Hamilton's term in the Federalist in describing why we have senatorial confirmation to begin with. Extreme is the word we're more likely to be concerned about. Oh, the extremists that the other party is going to name. It's of course always the other party who names extreme judges. It's never our party which names extreme judges. And that may be why the view on the filibuster seems to flip. The very same people who celebrated the demise of the lower court filibuster under Senate under the Democrats and Majority Leader Reid are acting as if it's the end of the world when the filibuster for the Supreme Court is ended under Majority Leader McConnell. And indeed, it isn't just a recent phenomenon. I once had spent an entertaining morning reading all of the New York Times editorials on the filibuster going back about 50 years, and there wasn't a single example of when the New York Times ever took a view on the filibuster contrary to what was going to favor the immediate short-term interests of the political party that it was supporting. But the argument for the filibuster, again, is that that the most extreme and unfit characters are going to be knocked off more easily if there is a filibuster. That's a nice theory. I do not think modern history bears out that that is what either political party does in its resistance to judicial nominations. In fact, I think it is much more the opposite, that they go after the strongest and most able, the best nominees of the other party. They are much more likely to be the targets of political attack than the mediocre, unfit, and possibly just biased and unpersuadable judges from the other side. During the Reagan administration, when I first started paying attention to this, the three judges, and this is when the partisanship of the process really kicked into high gear, the three judges who were confirmed with the largest number of negative votes, so this is when, these are the ones who would have been killed by the filibuster, were Alex Kaczynski, J. Harvey Wilkinson, and Douglas Ginsburg. I do not think anyone would say that they were the most extreme and unfit characters. They may have been, you know, certainly among President Reagan's best nominees. Under Clinton, it was more of a strategy of delay, and the two judges who were confirmed with the longest delay under President Clinton were Willie Fletcher and Richard Páez. Again, I don't think those would be on anybody's list of the most unfit and extreme characters. The only judicial nominee of President Obama who was successfully blocked by the use of the filibuster was Goodwin Liu. I assume people know Goodwin. I don't see shocked, horrified faces out there. Goodwin Liu, a just very distinguished, brilliant, very left-wing, but distinguished, brilliant professor from University of California Law School, now on the California Supreme Court. It's interesting that the first Supreme Court justice nominee ever to be really filibustered, not just threatened to be filibustered, but really where there were enough votes against cloture to block filibuster is Neil Gorsuch, first time ever. Clarence Thomas was bitterly opposed by Democratic senators. He was confirmed with, I should have looked this up, I think it's either 51 or 52 votes, 52 votes, someone is telling me. Things were so oppositional that the only Northern Democrat to vote in his favor, Alan Dixon of Illinois, was defeated in the primary the next year precisely because of his vote. It was surely the most contentious nomination of my lifetime, and no one even suggested using the filibuster, right? The filibuster was not on the table. To read the newspapers today, you would think that the so-called nuclear option that was just exercised is a massive change from American practice and will change the nature of the Senate forever. Have you read that? It will change the nature of the Senate forever. Not so. What would have changed the nature of the Senate forever is if a minority in the Senate can block an entirely qualified, mainstream, unobjectionable nominee to the Supreme Court, which would mean that no nominee could ever, of either party, could ever be confirmed, because you're always going to have more than 40 votes in the opposition. And if Neil Gorsuch is worthy of being filibustered and blocked, so will everybody else you can possibly think of. That's what would have been revolutionary. Gorsuch was the first partisan filibuster in Supreme Court nomination history. Thank goodness he is the last, and I say good riddance to the filibuster. Now, what about the filibuster for the lower courts? Has that been around for a long time? No, that came about for the first time in 2003 under George W. Bush. Was it wielded in order to block his most extreme, terrible, unfit nominations? Well, I know all of these people. One of the nominees who was blocked by use of the filibuster was Judge Carolyn Kuhl, who is a longtime distinguished Superior Court judge here in Los Angeles, who was overwhelmingly approved by the California Bar Association, which last time I checked is not a hotbed of right-wing extremism, right? She was the first woman to be Deputy Solicitor General of the United States, and she was blocked because of pro-abortion rights groups who objected to the fact that she had been part of the legal team under the Reagan administration who had carried the president's view on Roe versus Wade into the United States Supreme Court. Second person, another person who was successfully blocked by the filibuster is Miguel Estrada. Miguel is a very different personality than Carolyn, a very feisty personality, but this is a man who served with distinction in the Solicitor General's office under President Clinton for 5 years, and the two Solicitors General under whom he served testified on his behalf. He was blocked. I don't know why he was blocked. This is in the hearts of those who blocked him, but it sure looked like he was blocked because he was a conservative Republican Hispanic, and having a conservative Republican Hispanic just doesn't suit the partisan interests of the Democratic Party. I think that we see that both parties go after the best nominees, not the worst nominees. It actually reminds me of something Benjamin Franklin pointed out at the Constitutional Convention. He described a system for choosing a particular committee in Scotland in which each side got to disapprove of one of successive nominees by the other side until you got a committee that was completely, that everybody could agree with. And Franklin said that this was called knocking the brains out of the committee, because what you're left with are people who are so mediocre, undistinguished, that nobody has any complaints about them. I do not think that that's the kind of federal judiciary that we should want. Now, I think the filibuster is well and truly dead. One of the nice things about the nuclear option, whether wielded by Senator Reid or by Senator McConnell, both, one of the nice things about that is that once over, it's over, and it's not going to be what's sauce for the goose is sauce for the gander. The Democrats are living with the results of what they did last time. The Republicans will live with the results of what they are doing this time. It cuts across the board. I like that, and I think it's over. The problem that the other major device used by the Senate to frustrate Republican nominees, and I'm being told that it's my time. Can I have 2 minutes? Is simply delay. When the other party controls the Senate, they don't give hearings. They don't send people to the floor. Merrick Garland is only the most recent and conspicuous example of this phenomenon, but it has happened to many nominees to the courts of appeals over the last 20 years. And the problem with this is that it is not across the board, right? It does depend upon, at any given time, it's going to, it has a definite partisan valence. And I don't have, and it can't be killed. You can't do the nuclear option on this. It's with us. It's not, we're really stuck. It's not, I think, a good or constructive thing. But I don't know anything to do with it. Shy of a constitutional amendment, which isn't going to happen. But the last thing I want to mention to you is just to praise a suggestion made by James Madison on the floor of the Constitutional Convention in Philadelphia in 1787, when Madison proposed that judicial nominees be approved when nominated by the president unless within a certain period of time, he left that blank, 3 months, 4 months, 6 months, right? Within a certain period of time, the Senate disapproves by a vote of, and he leaves us blank, I think he had in mind something like 2/3, but it could even be a simple majority, doesn't matter really what it is. But what that would mean is that mere delay could not take place. And that, if that amendment had been adopted, Merrick Garland would be on the Supreme Court today, right? But more important, but the same rule would apply to the nominee of a Republican president, right? So the nice thing about a constitutional rule is that, much like the nuclear option for the filibuster, is that it restrains both sides. But in my opinion, the politics of the judiciary are, on balance, actually constructive and healthy. And I believe that the Senate, rather than improving matters by having more authority to block presidential appointments, more likely, on balance, harms the process and results in less distinguished, less able appointments to the judiciary. So my idea of reform is reduce the Senate's role, keep the nuclear option in place, and allow the natural process of the a change of presidents every 8 years to continue to produce a high quality, bipartisan, elite, backward looking, balanced, regionally diverse, slightly leaning against the president judiciary. Thank you.
Already running a few minutes late, but I'd like to open it up for 5 or 6 minutes of question and answer. And so please speak clearly because we have a live audience on the feed. And if I think you're speaking a little low, I'll repeat your question so Professor McConnell can answer. Yes, Dave.
On the regional diversity, that in some ways is surprising. Presidents don't have to tolerate regional diversity. Is that from their deference?
You know, that's a great question. It may be an exception. I don't think you may be right. I'm not being entirely consistent. What that stems from most immediately is the blue slip policy that allows senators to block nominees from their states. I don't actually quite approve of that. I think it's too rigid. But looking back over time, the practice of presidents heavily deferring, at least, to the senators when there's going to be a nomination to a position within their state goes all the way back to George Washington, who failed to do that in one of his early appointments. I believe it was to the collector of the port of Savannah. I may have that wrong, but I believe that's what it was. And to his surprise, his nominee was not confirmed. And he said, and he never made that mistake again. He always conferred with the local senator. So I think that that's I think that may not just be a product of rules such as the blue slip policy, but of a kind of deep logic of the way presidents and senates are going to interact.
Yes, Eric.
Your story about Gorsuch, I thought, was maybe just an inch or so incomplete in that a Senate majority blocked an obviously qualified and centrist candidate, not postponed, but blocked a centrist, moderate Supreme Court candidate. And I don't think, whatever we think of the board confirmation process, I'm very critical of Democrats for that process, he was not a centrist, moderate candidate. I think that's the first time, right, that a Senate majority, I mean, Thomas got in, right? Thomas got in 59-48.
I just meant it's the first time. Filibuster was the mechanism. The other mechanism is delay and failure to act. And certainly, I think I said Merrick Garland was as an example of that.
The point is that was effectively a filibuster. I mean, not filibuster, but it was effectively the first time a moderate, well-qualified Supreme Court justice did not get on the Supreme Court because of the actions of the majority. My only point about that is...
No, I think that's right. I totally agree with that. I don't get too much into high dudgeon about it because both parties... I mean, the Democrats had announced under Bush that they would do the same thing. I think it's a bad idea, but it is not as if it was any surprise.
Biden announced, the
Democrats. Biden did, Schumer did, yes.
McHugh.
Michael, that was a great talk. One final footnote on Garland. Given that we're seeing highly partisan votes in the Senate, suppose Garland had gotten a hearing. There's no guarantee, actually, he gets a positive vote out of committee or on the floor. So my one little footnote is it's not altogether clear to me that if Madison's amendment had prevailed or if that system would be in place and we filled in the blank with the president's nominee will take office unless blocked by 51, it's not altogether clear to me that we'd have to keep on Justice Garland. It might very well be that the Democrats said yes and the Republicans said no, rolling the dice for the 2016 election, which they ended up winning.
Yeah, of course. I mean, you're right. But then the Republicans would have had to vote no on Merrick Garland. And let me just tell you, I mean, I can't prove this, but I can tell you based upon people that I know, 51 Republicans were not prepared to vote against Merrick Garland. They were willing to maintain what they regarded as an unfortunate tradition of not approving judicial nominations in the last year of a presidency, something which had been used with lower court judges many, many times. They were prepared to, but voting against Merrick Garland was not in the cards, I think, for a number of Republicans, precisely because of what an excellent nominee he was.
And on the flip side, though, it's interesting that almost every Democrat did vote against Gorsuch.
Your conclusion from that is what?
That given the highly partisan nature, increasingly, of the process, and in the long run, what goes around comes around, what sauce for one is what sauce for the other, it might very well be that we're moving toward a world in which Republicans are going to say, well, if you're going to vote against Gorsuch, we're going to feel free to vote against the Garlands.
Yeah. I agree with that. We've been lurching from a bad thing to worse thing to worse thing to worse thing, you know, at least since the middle 1980s, on this. And I think Republicans would have, my view is that, I can't prove it, but my view is Republicans would have been unwilling to cast a vote against Merrick Garland as a person. I think the Democrats have now ratcheted up, because voting against Neil Gorsuch as a person was a shameless thing to do, shamelessly partisan thing to do. And the next time the shoe is on the other foot, Republicans will, I guarantee they will be just as bad as the Democrats, and highly predict that they will even be worse.
Okay, we have time for one more question. Richard?
You mentioned a couple of times that Gorsuch, this is the only filibuster, but how about the eight quarters filibuster? I know the other McConnell referred to this one as the only partisan one, but that was effectively partisan because it was Republicans and Southern Democrats who were
I mean, I think you could answer your own question better than I. This is your field. It was not a partisan filibuster. There were not enough votes to sustain Abe Fortas anyway. And the principal thing that was going on is that senators had confidentially seen the FBI reports that showed what Abe Fortas was up to, and they could not say that publicly because of the confidentiality of those reports, but they were not going to let a person of his character become Chief Justice of the United States. That is not a partisan thing. That is possibly, I mean, it's one of the few times in American history in which the unfit character was, in fact, blocked by the Senate.
It was a minority. He got majority votes cast for cloture.
I forget the exact partisan breakdown. Lots of Democrats agreed, and I don't think they were all Southern Democrats, but I could be wrong about that.
Well, give it a